morning, everyone. It is February 7th, 2015, and it's about 8:20 a.m. I am here outside of the Keene Activism Center, where a few activists are inside eating breakfast, getting ready for a school board meeting. Ooh, very exciting. Not. It's so boring. But it's really important, you know. It's a Saturday morning. Most people want to sleep in and be with their families or enjoy some rest from a long week at work, and they don't want to be going to a school board meeting. Now, that works against them, because you know who will show up to the school board meeting? A bunch of teachers and bureaucrats and people who benefit from the taxpayer money that this school board is about to dole out. So the people who want money are going to tell the school board, oh, it's so important, we need this money for, you know, the kids and the children, and oh, it's really for them to get richer and get what they want, right? And if they don't have any opposition, then they will get what they want. So it's important that the community, whoever that is, the community who's interested in what happens here, shows up and makes their voice known. Now, activists get a lot of criticism for civil disobedience, working outside the system, disobeying the laws. Well, one of the remedies that these people who criticize activists for that say is, well, you should use the system. Well, here are the activists using the system, but I guarantee you're going to see that these school board people are very upset, and other members of the community are going to be very upset that people like Conan Solada are using the system to introduce some warrant articles suggesting that the community reduce the budget. I mean, normally in most jurisdictions or most towns, the budgets for the town, the school board, all increase every year. It's just a matter of fact, like gravity. Taxes go up because the bureaucrats want to spend more money, and look, like these meetings, they're unopposed. There's no downward pressure on what these people are spending. So this is a very unique example of what activists concentrated in one geographic area can do together. So Conan, Daryl, Johnson, Danica, Ian, and me, and several others will be showing up to this school board meeting at 8:30 in the morning, signing up, introducing these warrant articles, and voting on them, making our voices known, using the system, right? And the people are going to be very upset, I predict, because they don't want the budget to be decreased. They're going to act like that is the end of the world, that people who want a static budget just don't care about the children, don't care about education, and that's not true. I do care about education and children, but I don't think it's insane that money be managed well. And you know, especially if this money is for the children. Keene schools have lost students for the last 5 years. So if the number of students is decreasing, theoretically, if the money is for the students, shouldn't the budget also be decreasing? You know, there's just too many arguments in favor of a fiscally responsible budget. But we'll see what happens. Now, another interesting thing about this morning is I'm going to bring this video camera into the school. Now, I am banned in all Keene schools, but that ban only takes effect Monday through Friday, 6 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. weekdays. So, you know, why am I banned? You can look up some of my past videos where I hand out literature outside of these government schools, and the government doesn't like that. You can't hand out literature, you can't have a free exchange of ideas with other individuals. No, that is not allowed on public property, remember, because schools are public property. But I was banned from that, as crazy as that may sound. So now it's Saturday, so I'm not banned. I'm gonna bring my camera in, because people never get to see what's inside these schools. I mean, even teachers, they call them public schools, but they're not really public, are they? I mean, what would happen to you if you walked into a school with a video camera and started asking questions about what goes on there? You know, you'd be bounced right out, and you might even be arrested. So I'm gonna get whatever video I can. I do have work today. I'm gonna open and close at the libertarian-owned thrift store here in Keene, 101 Deals. And you can like us on Facebook, facebook.com/101deals, thrift store. And so I've got a full day ahead of me. So for those criticisms, people who say, oh, get a job, you bum, you know, I'm hitting on all cylinders here. I'm attending activism in the morning, I'm going to work a real job afterwards, and then I'm going to go home and edit some podcasts and continue my activism. So, if you find this sort of thing exciting or interesting, I urge you to check out FreeKeene.com and, more importantly, FreeStateProject.org. That's FreeStateProject.org. It's an idea of moving 20,000 liberty-loving activists to the same geographic location to get active for freedom. This isn't happening anywhere else. So join us. Hey everyone, it's Derek J. It's still February 7th, Saturday, 2015, and I'm about to walk into a school board meeting here at Keene High School. Now, one of the points that I was making earlier that I feel I didn't make fully is that so many people who... Thank you very much.
There's no video in this building.
Oh, it's Saturday, it's okay. Thank you. So, yeah, the point I was trying to make is that people who benefit from money that comes from the school board have a much greater incentive to appear here than people who pay for the things that happen here. So, for example, if you are an administrator or a teacher who wants an increase in the budget, well, you might be getting $100,000 just for your paycheck, but a person who pays the school board a nominal increase in the budget isn't going to mean that much to their bottom line, you know. They don't have an incentive. It might be an extra $20 or $100. Well, they're not going to show up to a meeting if it's just that small, but if you're getting a pay increase of like $1,000 or a couple $1,000s, you have a much greater incentive to show up. So that's my point. So I just walked into the school, and this is what I see. There's a line of people at tables, and it looks like I have to check in. So I'm going to see, according to my last name, because you have to be a registered voter, which I am here in Keene. So I'm going to go do that now. E D, E to K. Hello.
Good morning.
My name is Derek Horton.
Can you film and write at the same time?
Because
you
I think
to
I
sign
could.
Your ballots.
I'd right be happy here. To.
Okay. Right across the top.
Sure. I'm gonna get a shot of this so I can see, let other people see what is going on
and
here
today.
And your
first name, please?
My name is Derek.
Oh, thank you. And you're at 75 Leverett Street.
That's correct.
All right. So we'll just tell you about this, that this is your ticket in and out if you need to go to the bathroom in the middle, for example.
Make Certainly.
Sure you have that so you can get back in.
Okay, this piece of paper, this purple
right
one?
Right across, yeah.
Okay.
Just right now. And if we have written ballots, we'll vote so bottom up.
Monday.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I appreciate it. Mm-hmm. So, anything else that I need to do here?
Nope.
I just hold on to this?
Yep, and then you can go right in.
And I need this if I go to the bathroom, you said?
And then maybe if you come out, you'll need it to get back.
I see. Thank you. All right. Have a great day.
Good morning.
Oh, looks like Ian's showing up behind me. Morning.
Morning.
Some will. Pick up a copy of this.
Okay.
Hey, Ian. How's it going?
It is going splendid.
Yeah.
There's Fred Parcells.
Oh, there he is. Yeah, he came onto my house driveway once and peeked into the garage. I have some video of that. It's pretty weird. I don't think they're supposed to do that.
You'd be creepy.
Yeah, pretty creepy. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hey, how's it going, Fred?
Well,
I guess he doesn't want to say good morning. These are your so-called public officials, right? They're so accountable to the people, right? He doesn't even want to say hello. So this is what it looks like when you walk in. It's a big empty auditorium. Rick from Cheshire TV is here.
Hi, Derek.
Hey, good morning, Rick.
How are you, bud?
I'm terrific.
Long time.
Yeah, it has been a while. I'm loving the programming coming from Cheshire TV.
Good.
So, looks like some public officials are accountable, but he's not elected. he's just a nice guy who works at the local TV station. And you can watch local TV here in Keene by going to CheshireTV.org. You can actually watch it live streamed. So I just want to get a shot of this before everyone shows up. So here's what it looks like. Now these are the names of the school board members. Some of these people, like Chris Coates, are also city council members. Looks like there's going to be a podium for people to speak, and we have some other names here that might be showing up. And as you can see, it's pretty empty at this point. Now, it was my understanding that this starts at 8:30, but I guess you really just, maybe doors open at 8:30. I'll try and get another shot of this when more people fill out the seats, or maybe there won't be that many people in attendance, who knows. But you can see, I mean, if you had 100 activists here, you'd own this place. So it's a dangerous proposition when people say, you should use the system. Really? You might not want that. Because we might reduce the budget, God forbid. Oh, here's an activist I know. He's a recognizable face. That's James Robin Hood Cleveland. He probably wants lots of evil things to happen here today, like reducing the budget.
I think they'll pitch a fit if I plug my computer in.
No, you can plug your computer in. It's the people's power. I have that on record.
Really?
Yeah, one of the Keene police. Remember, before he arrested me, they said, Whose power is it when we were plugged into the gazebo? And he said, it's the people's power.
Do you like peanut butter cookies?
Oh, no way. You have peanut butter cookies?
We made them last night. These are the best peanut butter cookies. They're 3-ingredient peanut butter cookies.
3 ingredients? Yeah. Isn't there only
1 cup of peanut butter, a cup of sugar, and 1 egg?
Wow.
And it's easy.
That's nice and simple. I dig it. Well, thank you. I just had breakfast over at the Keene Activism Center, but I'm
all
full.
You're never too full for a cookie.
I'm trying to lay off the sweets, man. You know, summer's coming. The weather's getting warmer. Anyway, thanks. Thanks for the offer. I appreciate it. All right. Well, that'll do it for now. I'll try and get some more video when something else interesting happens. Okay, hey everyone, so I'm inside the school board meeting and I have my little hall pass. This is apparently what you need to enter and exit because I'm a registered voter. Oh, hey, look, some activists are here. Ready to do some voting? Well, that's pretty cool. Or maybe they're just watching, I'm not quite sure. So I'm going to go around the school and see what I can see.
Ed is making Valentine cookies for Friday.
So New Hampshire is a pretty unique place. It's one of the most accessible places that I've ever been. Of course, you don't need to be a resident here to have total gun freedoms. You can strap a gun to your hip and walk around all over the place. Well, school's not one of those places, unfortunately. Oh, look, some stuff is going on in here. I wonder what this is. Looks like there's a cop and maybe some city councilors. I'm not quite sure. But they're meeting in the library. And so this is what the library looks like. It's pretty cool. It's got some skylights, that's nice. It's got some computers. Okay, what else do we have here? Ooh, looks like some artwork is being displayed. Oh, there's lots of artwork here. It looks like there's some celebrities, caricatures. Oh. Here's a big word with a definition on it. So this is one of the things that Keene high schoolers must see every day. It has the word dream. That's kind of nice. And, you know, I wonder who made this. It looks like it might even be student made. And it says, I'll just get a still shot of it. I like that it's a big, thorough definition, includes both the noun and the verb, and each has multiple definitions, and is used in a sentence. Great question to be asking. So I see here's a sign that's posted on the wall, and I don't see many of these. I'm wondering if there are some kinds of restrictions about posting things on the walls. Compared to where I grew up, these walls look pretty bare, so I wonder if there's some restriction on that. These look cute. We had things like this in high school called candy grams. And I'm not really quite sure what they were used for or what to benefit. They were like a fundraiser for clubs and stuff. Looks like there's chips and soda. Pretty typical. Oh, more posters. Oh, wow, LSD. What's this one? Facts. Yeah, a tiny amount can add up to 12 hours or more of effects. Hmm. Ooh, look at that, that's trippy. Ooh. Don't take LSD, kids. Ooh. Now, LSD is probably not a very good thing for students of high school age to be taking. I do not recommend that, but, you know, it's interesting to see something like LSD next to, let's say, tobacco, which is the number one killer in America, contributor to heart disease. I don't know if it's actually the number one. Let's see. In the U.S., more than 1,300 people die each day due to smoking. I don't see anything like that over here. I wonder if marijuana's on here. No. Oh, wait, there it is. Marijuana. How many deaths? Zero. Oh, of course, that's not listed. Addictive? 1 in 6 people become addicted. Citation needed. Oh, weed and success. Yes, because the two are mutually exclusive. There are no successful people who have ever enjoyed marijuana on a regular basis. Not doctors, CEOs. Silly. Now, tobacco, that is horrible. It's a very dangerous drug. Of course, heroin. Nothing good about heroin. Lots of good facts on this one. I could stay here all day, but I do want to move on and see what else this school has to offer. Oh, I like this one. Look, it includes so many. Don't get caught in the web. All right. Ooh, French club. Poster. Looks like some literature. Oh, free. Cool. Kids reading. This is good. I like that. Little length schedule of what's going on for sports teams. Looks like a cafeteria. Yep, some kids like reading and eating and stuff. Trophies. Bird feeder, that's weird. I guess their team mascot is some kind of bird, I'm not really sure. And here's what appears to be another entrance to the school. Now you'll notice there's no creepy metal detectors or intrusive security procedures for entering and exiting the school, though things seem to be safe. Oh, here's something going on down this hallway. It's like a creepy hallway. Anyway, it's getting about time for the school board meeting to start, so I want to get over there and make sure I can vote and have my voice be heard. Now remember, I've got my hall pass, so they are supposed to let me back in. Oh wow, the teacher's lounge looks like super accessible. I'm impressed. I don't remember the teacher's lounge being accessible in the high school I grew up in. You certainly couldn't look in and see like a refrigerator, toaster oven, and people hanging out. So that's kudos to them. Wow, another piece of cool, trippy art. You know, I have to say, I am impressed with Keene High School. I am impressed with their accessibility. I'm impressed with their openness and their lights, the comfortability of walking around. Like, they got a news bulletin board. They've got lots of student art things on display. This is terrific. I wouldn't be too upset as a student here. I think I might enjoy it. Some more art. So, this is what you, the taxpayers of Keene, are paying for. So I just thought you should be able to have a look at it. Alright, let's see how full the room is now.
Good luck. Oh, that's good.
Good morning. We got Ian Freeman here on his laptop. Probably doing some activism stuff, getting ready.
It's usually a slow start here.
Yeah.
Probably ramp up. Typically it ramps up to around 100 attendees within the first hour. So you're going to see probably about 90% teachers, school board employees. They dominate the meeting. If activists could get 100 people in Keene, we would be able to turn everything around in this meeting, at least in theory.
Cool. Yeah. Okay, now I'm going to go back to where I was seated over here with James Cleveland. I'm going to pass Fred Parcells again. Say hello to him. Hey! Hey, how's it going?
Your attention, please.
Good morning.
At this time, please take a moment to look around the room and to the right and left to note the location of the emergency exit signs. In the event of an emergency, lights will come on, allowing you to see to move to the nearest exit. Upon leaving the space, please follow the exit signs to the nearest outside egress. Please move quickly and in an orderly manner. Thank you.
I guess I'm going to take my hall pass.
Yeah, you better. Start here. Now, you'll notice that this, better zoom out. So this cop behind me here is some kind of detective, and he testified against James in his recent trial for filming a police officer. Oh, he's gonna walk off camera. So he testified against James saying that, he testified against me. Gosh, that was interesting. He said, oh, you know, Derek's got this criminal record. He's been arrested for possession of marijuana, so he shouldn't have his right to conceal a firearm. Of course, that's still ongoing. I've taken that issue to the Supreme Court. And here's Fred Parcells. Yeah, he's one of the code enforcers in Keene. He drives around making sure that cars aren't parked where they're not supposed to be and that people don't have unregistered vehicles in their driveways. Now, one time he actually went as far as opening my garage door to check to see if there were unregistered vehicles there. That's a big no-no. Not allowed to step on other people's property and start inspecting things. One of my friends joked that, would he do the same if it were if you were looking for unregistered Jews or something? It's a harsh example, but You know, the point is, people deserve their privacy. Are we free or are we not? Looks like things are almost ready to get started. I'll start the camera rolling again once they announce something. But as you can see, I would predict there are probably 30 or 40 people in attendance right now. I wonder how many of them are receiving a paycheck or some sort of benefit from the school versus how many of them are, you know, people who don't have kids in the school who are just concerned about the budget or their taxes, you know. I would predict that most people in attendance here this morning are people who are on the receiving end of the benefits from taxpayer money. So here's the man of the hour. Hey, Conan, you gonna be introducing any bills today?
Four petition warrant articles dealing with lowering the school district's budget over time, and one that deals strictly with the electioneering that goes on, which is unacceptable behavior. There's already a law against it, but you know, hey, these guys, they'll break laws whenever they can. No problem.
Cool. So, which ones are yours?
They are the ones at the very end.
Okay.
Whatever those. So hopefully, 30 seconds. There's not a whole lot going on like last year, and it was a 6-hour event. Hopefully we can get done maybe 3.
All right. Good luck.
We'll see what happens.
Last year, Keene School District awarded more than serving students. So it's a list of people who contributed in celebration of all that good stuff. And then there is
good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
An appreciation
of Abraham
Lincoln.
Deliberative session for 2015. My name is Joseph Hoppick, and I'm the moderator for the meeting. To my right is John Wrigley, the clerk, Beth Zinn. The school board is before us here. We have administration officials right here. Before we get started, I'd like to run over a few rules of the meeting. This is a deliberative session, which means we're going to deliberate the articles that will appear on the warrant on March 13th when we go to vote on them. So amendments are permitted to the articles if you want to make them, and we'll vote on them at the time. Now, when we vote on these articles, or the amendments rather, we can vote on them by ballot measure if 5 people sign a petition or a request in writing requesting a ballot vote on the amendment. And everybody should have received a purple sheet with various ballots that are perforated. Tear them off when the time comes and use those. Now, I want to make a couple of remarks about these purple sheets. You see at the bottom of the first page, it begins with ballot question B, and then it goes up to C, D, E, F, G, H, and I. We're going to go up in that order. So you start with the bottom one first, and we'll go through with respect to each ballot vote. We'll go up the sheet, and then we'll use those. If you use the wrong ballot letter, we can't count it because we don't know if you're stuffing the ballot, basically. So please be sure, and I'll remind you at the time that we vote, which ballot sheet you're going to use. Does everybody have one, first of all? Okay, good. So we'll move on from there. I do have already a request for a written ballot on any amendments to Article 1. So we'll be voting on that, any amendments to Article 1 by written ballot. And if anybody wants to present a request, they should bring it up here and give it to myself or Beth Zinn, the clerk. We'll honor that request. Now, a couple of rules. We have microphones. I'm sorry, we have one over there by Fred Parcells. And I can't see where the other one was, but it used to be right here. Where? Okay, got it. Thank you. You'll be given a sheet you can ask Gene Harper or Fred Parcells for a sign-up sheet. Put your name and address on that sheet. Fred's walking over here. And we will bring them up here, and we'll try to keep them in order and call your name when it's time. And then you can speak, and if you want to speak again, fill out another sheet. I would ask everybody to be mindful of what other people have said and not be unnecessarily redundant about comments. If it's said once, it really doesn't need to be said again. So, with that said, I would ask everybody to be respectful of others' opinions and just have our deliberation so we can vote in an orderly manner and move on from there. I have a couple of announcements. For those of you who will not be able to, may have trouble seeing the PowerPoint presentation during today's meeting, there is a hard copy handout that you can get from Caitlin. She's sitting right there to my right. And the other point I want to make is that the Keene School District has a website, and on the website there's various information on the budget, materials that you can click on and look at on your computer. There's banners for that on the website. So if you're having trouble following along with the written material provided today, you can always access the website. Okay, does anybody have any questions before we begin? One more thing I want to mention. I may be asked during the course of this meeting to make a ruling on a procedural matter. I don't follow Robert's rules because I don't know them, and I don't want to know them. My rule is fairness and equal opportunity for everyone to speak. So I'm going to be guided by that principle. And there are certain legal requirements we're bound by. That's why John Wrigley is here to my right. He's the lawyer for the school district. And I may consult with him on a point, but once I make a ruling, that's the rule. You can overrule me if you want to make a point of order and a motion to overrule the moderator. If you make that motion, it needs to be seconded, and a majority of you can overrule me. If there's no majority vote, then I'm not overruled. Is everybody clear about that procedure? Yes.
How do you know if you're going to speak or not before something brought? You said get a piece of paper.
Yeah, Mr. Parcells or Ms. Harper can give you a piece of paper. Well, you look confused.
I may not want to speak until halfway through.
Well, then you fill it out then. Oh. And give it to the lady.
Okay.
You'll have plenty of time, I promise, to speak. We're not going anywhere, right? Okay. Now, with those remarks, seeing no other questions, I'll turn the meeting over to the chair of the board, Chris Coates.
Good morning. At this time, I'd like to have Thomas Zott, who is a Keene middle schooler, grade 6, come down and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
We stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Thomas. And now I'd like to, I've heard these guys many times, and they're from the Keene A Cappella Choir. They're separate from them, but it's all young ladies from Keene High School, and their group is called Momentum. And if they could come over for a second and just introduce themselves, that would be great, and then they're going to be singing the national anthem.
So proudly we hailed at the twilight.
correct me if I'm wrong, in May they have an incredible evening called Nostalgia Night, where they all do group acts and they singular, you know, solo acts. It's just an incredible evening of music. So look for that in May. As my time as chair of the Keene Board of Education comes to a close, I'd like to take a moment to talk about some of the areas the Keene School District has been working diligently on in the past year. We've been working hard to improve the core foundation of all our schools, and I know that for the foreseeable future, we will continue to address those goals of our strategic plan. Those goals are to build a positive school culture for all students, ensure our curriculum and instructional practices are challenging and meaningful and inspiring for our students, gather and analyze data on our culture, curriculum, and instructional practices to ensure consistent growth and improvement in these areas. We understand that each school is at a different pace in this process. At the same time, we are working together as a district to help each school move forward and for them to find success and growth. Principals and teachers have come together to collaborate on levels that we have not seen in years. This commitment from the administrations, principals, and teachers to a common vision has galvanized a clear direction for all our staff that their community should be proud of. The Keene School District has been working to make sure we prepare for the new challenges of Common Core standards. We have stayed clear of and not allowed ourselves to be slowed down by the politics of standardized testing and the development of the Common Core in our district. We have welcomed higher expectations and understand that there is a new normal in place, that being the smarter balanced testing that will be occurring this spring. As the Keene School District becomes more familiar with this tool, it is our expectation that the Keene School District will rise to meet this challenge and soon be seen as a leader in the state of New Hampshire. The Keene School District has developed a new teacher evaluation tool, which has principals and assistant principals observing in the classrooms more often than what past practices were. This is a cultural change in our district, and early findings have shown positive results because of the frequency of the administration being in the classroom, as this allows for more discussion and feedback. The increased visits by administration in their conversation about improving instruction has clearly helped our teachers and schools to better meet the needs of every student. This year, the Keene School District has focused on the development of the 2015-16 budget on what is called student-based budgeting. This focuses the level of funding on what each school receives based on their student enrollment in their building, as well as the demographics of each school. This budget is a true reflection of balancing the quality of education and at the same time minimizing the tax impact. The Keene School District continues to look at new ways to generate revenue to help offset the decreased enrollment and the decreased or underfunding from the state of New Hampshire. Last March, the board and the community approved the development of an endowment. I'm proud to say that the board of directors has been put in place and bylaws that allow the governance of the board have been adopted. As of October 2014, we have been designated as 503C nonprofit status. The Keene Education Endowment is now reality, and it is our hope that early this fall, we will be sending out our first fundraising letters to over tens of thousands of former Keene High graduates. I would be remiss if I didn't recognize Ann Zod, who spearheaded the development of the Keene Educational Endowment. Without her leadership and dedication, we may not be as far along as we are today. Over the past 3 years, we've worked hard to develop a partnership with the Monadnock Regional School District. Monadnock, like Keene, is seeing the same declining enrollment and less funding from the state of New Hampshire. Their struggles are the same as ours, that being how to ensure that every student who walks through our doors graduates and is ready to be participating and a valued member of their community. It is time for the two school districts to look at the obvious, as they did in the late 50s and early 60s when our schools were overflowing with students. The Monadnock School District and the Keene School District were born along with the two high schools. It's time for us to have that discussion again. It's time for us to become one. This conversation will not be easy, and there will be many obstacles that could derail this dialogue. It is my hope that the boards continue to have those collaborative sessions that have been occurring, and the partnership continues to grow. As this is my last first session as chair of the Keene Board of Education, I want to thank the teachers, our district, and our teachers. I want to thank the teachers in our district for the magic they create and the dedication they have for every student in their classroom. I want to thank the administrators SAU, and the principals for their vision and leadership in helping us to continue to move the Keene School District forward. I want to thank my colleagues, past and present, on the Keene Board of Education for your tireless and passionate advocacy that you have for public education. You are second to none. It has been an honor serving all of you. I leave you with a quote from Nelson Mandela. Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. We will now turn to the 9 articles presented in the school warrant, and 4 articles in addition to the 9 were presented by petition from the public. We will take them in the order that will appear on the warrant. Article 1 reads, shall the district raise and appropriate as an operating budget, not including appropriations by special warrant articles and other appropriations voted separately, the amount set forth in the budget posted with the warrant or as amended by vote at the first session, for the purposes set forth therein, totaling $64,529,015. Should this article be defeated, the operating budget shall be $63,618,688, which is the same as last year with certain adjustments required by previous action of the district or by law. Or the governing body may hold one special meeting in accordance with RSA 40:13, Roman 10 and 16 to take up the issue of the revised operating budget only. That is the substance of the article. Do I hear any discussion?
Point of order.
Sir.
I think the number, Ted Parent, 242 Beaver Street. I think the numbers that you read is for the default budget were different from what's up on the board.
Then I may be reading from an old sheet. Okay, 64. Okay, thank you. 64,529, that's what I have, 15 is the operating budget.
It's the default budget that was different.
63,671,815. Okay, thank you. I stand corrected. Point of order noted. Any questions, comments, or anybody wishes to speak on Article 1? Seeing none, we'll move on to Article 2. Shall the district approve the cost items included in the... I didn't see it, okay. Probably too close. Yeah, go ahead.
So before we get into the detail of Article 1, we want to take a step back and kind of build off what Chris was talking about. There's going to be a lot of numbers today and a lot of percentages, but I think, you know, we really need to keep in mind what this whole district is galvanized around. We're galvanized around building a positive school culture in each one of our schools, making sure our curriculum and instruction are meaningful, inspiring, and challenging for all of our kids, and then making sure that we're tracking data on this work to make sure we're getting better at what we do. That's the big work. It gets lost in all the numbers. It gets lost in $64 million, but that's what we've committed to do, and that's our focus. We're happy to go into any details around things like cultural RTI, developmental designs, responsive classroom, understanding by design, smarter balance, lots and lots of edu speak in there, but we're happy to go into that detail when we need to. You know, and I think the main thing to keep in mind is, before Carl kind of gives us the big picture of this budget, is there's three things that are happening in this budget besides that big push. This budget is about what we need. We definitely need more supplies for the Common Core State Standards. When you look at the numbers, I think it's a pretty insignificant investment, but we definitely need that there. We definitely need to upgrade our infrastructure. Part of that's part of the elementary reconstruction, but there's other things we need to address as well. We also need technology upgrades. There is no doubt that we have a great new technology director, and he's doing fabulous work, but we have a lot of years where we did not have that, and we need to build that back up again. And we also need to continue on the path of the professional development. We have invested heavily in our staff in the last year and a half, and we need to continue to do that. And that's what's going to make all the points on the prior page happen. This budget is also about what we did not need. To go back to what Chris was saying, we had a lot of difficult conversations the last couple months. We had to actually really construct budgets around the number of kids we had in each building. That creates tough conversations, but we had them. We made some difficult choices, and they show up in this budget. So we need to keep that in mind as well. But also, the third major theme that this budget is about is our restructuring and renovation of the Keene Elementary Schools. We have a great 2-year plan in place. This is change, but it's stable change. And this budget makes sure that can happen. I'll go into more details of that later. And Mr. Pants is going to go into the big picture of the budget.
Okay, Article 1 was obviously just read to you by Mr. Hoppeck. I just want to explain one thing with Article 1, and that is if this article is defeated, the operating budget will be $63,671,815. And that is better known as the default budget. And the default budget, very simply, is last year's fiscal year's budget plus all of the contractual obligations that we owe we can't control. For example, bargaining agreements or insurance or what have you. We have no control over that. And that's added on to the last year's budget, and that's what's called the default budget. Basically, a very simple version of a definition of it. So we go on to the next slide. I got to make sure I speak into this microphone. I got scolded a little while ago, so if you can't hear me, let me know. We have the 2014-15 operating budget here, and that's last year's budget. And this year we're asking for $64,529,015. That's an increase of 1.1%, or $642,964. That's a very reasonable increase. Next slide. Okay, here's a bar chart explaining, I'm going to take this off here, it's much easier. A bar chart explaining what our spending looks like. And this gives you a clearer picture. For example, here is the contractual salaries and benefits. That's an expense. These are technology upgrades. We need new iPads and wiring and throughout the school. These are all major expenses, by the way. This is capital improvement, $167,000, $767,700. And we also have a common core supplies, that's of $72,057. We also are involved with the Keene Elementary construction, which we're going to be pouring in $689,273. However, we're also saving on the plus side the exact same amount. So we're using that savings to for the reconstruction of the elementary school. So you can see they're both exactly the same number. Other savings, we have out of district replacement savings of $611,000. We have special warrant articles of $100,000, which happen to be the reserve fund for facilities. And we have debt service of $51,248. So these are all the major issues that we're dealing with in the expense side. Next slide. This is exactly the same as that bar chart. It just breaks it down into text form. But what it shows is all of the major increases and all the major decreases. Those major expenses come to $508,762. All the rest of them, which are not major, totals $642,964. In other words, you're simply subtracting this from that, and that difference is the other minor expenses that are included. Okay, next slide. Okay, so here's in the revenue side, I have to mention something here. I have the unenviable task of explaining a very complicated budget to citizens who have not gotten involved with this thing, and so it's very difficult. And there may be a way of solving that problem, and I'll show you in a minute. The major revenue decreases and increases. Tuition, for example, we're expecting $158,671 extra. But we're losing here out on local revenue of $152,368. We're losing out in building aid of $138,687. We're losing out on the transfer to building fund or capital reserve of $100,000, although there'll be a warrant article matching that. We're also losing out in an unreserved fund balance surplus of $372,142. So your net decrease on your revenue side is $594,992. Your percent decrease is minus 1.87%. If you remember, our increase in the expense side was 1.01%. That was an increase. Our decrease on the revenue side is minus 1.87%. Okay, next slide. This is very hard to read, and for those people, yes, I know. You have this chart in your handout, but I wanted to explain something, if you can see some of this. But basically, this is your revenue picture, and these are all the cost centers related to the budget. In other words, you have preschool, you have grounds and facilities, you have Cheshire Career Center, you have Willard School, you have all the cost centers are located on this section right in here. And in this section, you'll have the increases and decreases that are associated with each cost center. And then we have a grand total over here of 64 million, $64,529,015, I guess it is. And you see there's the 1.01%. You really have to really like numbers to understand this. And we have the revenue side. We didn't break down the revenue, but we have a district revenue source of $31,804,500. We have a grand total. This is the revenue. This section right in here is what the taxes will be. In other words, we would have to make up the difference of that 1.1% increase in expenses, and we would have to make up the difference of that minus 1.87% in revenue. And that difference is 3.8%, or 3.8-something%, or 86%. We have to make up that difference. The way we make it up is through our property tax. And if you follow the so if you follow the bouncing ball, you'll find out exactly what your taxes are. Now, I don't expect you to know all of this or understand it, but I will say that it's in your handout. And this was obviously done on a spreadsheet, an Excel spreadsheet. So those people who like numbers and want to understand exactly what their taxes will be down here, you're going to ask the business office to send you a copy of this version in Excel, and you'll play with all the numbers you want. In other words, you can increase one cost center or decrease another cost center up here, and automatically down here you'll find out what your tax rate is. So for those of you who kind of like playing with numbers, we've given the citizens the opportunity to play their own games with the taxes. Okay, next slide. Okay, so basically, this is what we come up with. We have a revenue picture of, as I pointed out earlier, minus 1.87%. We have a expense increase of 1.01%. And the total comes to 3.86%. This is the amount that has to be raised by property taxes, 3.86%. Okay, next slide. Okay, these are the cost centers. I mentioned on that large chart that Mr. Black will be explaining all the decreases and increases related to the cost centers. So here you go.
Thank you, Carl. So I have the pleasure of going over all the details of different cost centers. I'll probably go to fairly brisk pace, but there's plenty of time for questions at the end, so if you have them, just save them and we're happy to go into them. So Jonathan Daniels is our first cost center. Obviously there's a big decrease there. That's because the school is going from 12 total sections to 6. There'll be no kindergarten there next year. This is all part of the restructuring plan, and there'll be 2 5th grades. So the lion's share of that reduction is 6 classrooms going away. We're also moving the LD Collaborative from Jonathan Daniels to Wheelock, so that's part of the reduction. But there's also an increase there because Jonathan Daniels is going to function as a full school, fully run school next year, and we need to make sure we're making the same investments for them that we're making all the elementary schools around our Common Core supplies. So total, they're down about $800,000 or 33% change. Then we go to Benjamin Franklin School. It's a pretty big increase because part of the restructuring plans, we have this first grade group that's a little bit larger. And just demographically, a lot of them live in the Franklin area. So we have to increase that by one total section. So it'll be this third section that kind of continues through Franklin over the next 4 years. So we need an additional teacher there. We also had to increase a paraprofessional from full-time to part-time to better meet the needs of our special ed students. And there's one student who needed an LPN. So all those kind of drove some higher increases, but we are, you know, right-sizing the school to the kids who are there, making sure they have enough funds. We are also increasing the Common Core supplies for them with math, writing, and ELA programs. So there's an investment in there as well. And also, I think what's new is, you know, there's a certain number of kids who've kind of fallen behind there. We've definitely had up and down leadership there over a couple of years. That's all changed with Eric Kress becoming our principal and stable there. And I think what he really wants to focus on, there's a chunk of kids who are struggling that shouldn't struggle. So the teachers and him want to put in some extra time after school to make sure they close that gap next year. So that represents about $265,000, or about a 9% increase of the Franklin budget, but it's what they need. Next slide. If we go to the Fuller School, Fuller is largely staying the same. There's not a lot of really significant changes. What you see in that $126,000 increase is, you know, we had a new contract for the KEA, and there's teachers there, and they got increases in their salaries, and that drove most of the change. There's definitely a slight increase also in terms of supplies for math, writing, and ELA, but largely Fuller is not changing a lot as a part of restructuring next year, so, you know, the basically just contractual increases at Fuller. Next slide. We go to Simon, similar theme. There's not a lot of major changes at Simon. It's largely that $135,000 increase is largely contractual changes. Again, there's a contract, and teachers got raises, and that got captured in there. And they're also getting an increase in supplies for the Common Core around math, writing, and ELA. So that represents about $135,000. Next slide. Then we go to Wheelock School. Kind of like Franklin, there is a dramatic change. I mean, so they are getting the LD Collaborative. They're increasing their number of kids. And then there's also an OT that was inside the special ed cost center that we've moved in here because that's where they work. So it's more of an accounting thing. It's neutral in the budget. But at the same time, though, those costs came in. So when you look at the movement of the LD Collaborative, that OT, and then also that investment in the Common Core supplies, it leads to about $211,000, about 10% increase in their budget. But they're getting more kids, and it's what they need. If we go to the next slide. Elementary General is basically the fund where, you know, there's certain activities that the elementary schools share, so that's what this one is. There is now going to be, we're going to start to rebuild our world language program in Keene Elementary Schools. We're going to start with kindergarten next year, so we need a part-time teacher to do that. So that's part of the $250,000, a very small part, about $24,000 of it. We basically had to adjust our teacher substitute costs, so that's part of the increases. We also are in the process of hiring a floating nurse. We're consistently without nurses when nurses go sick, and that's a problem. So we've adjusted that in this budget, and we're absorbing those costs in next year's budget. So this is the place where we represented the cost for the elementary school. So if there's ever a nurse out in our elementary school, we make sure we have someone there, so we solve that problem. And then also, kind of an accounting thing, the special ed coordinator for the district for elementary schools used to be sitting in the special ed side of this budget. We just moved it into here because that's where they spend their time. So that represents actually a significant change in the $250,000. And then we also had to make sure we fully funded our summer school transportation. So that's a big increase of $250,000, but it's what we need based on you know, our schools. So next slide. Keene Middle School, not a lot of major changes. There's a $100,000 increase or 1.5%. Some of that is, it's accounting again. We moved the Vistas teachers from their special ed part of the budget into their budget because that's where they work. That's the majority of the change here. There's some contractual increases that went along with the KEA contract. We covered part of the floating nurse for Keene Middle School, and then there's an additional sports stipend to kind of help the school. Runs program, so that's basically what happened at Keene Middle School. Not a lot of group or activity there, kind of a minor increase. We go to Keene High School. Keene High School, $635,000 change, around 4.6%. A lot of that is driven by the contract. We have about 140 teachers in Keene High School, so if there's going to be an increase in salaries, a lot of it's going to get captured there. We're also putting in two monitors in Keene High School. So one monitor is for the hall monitor basically after school. We want to make sure that there's always a presence in the building. There's a lot of things going on in this building on all hours of the day, so we want to keep that presence. And then we want to make sure the library is open longer, because a lot of kids should be getting homework done and getting their work done after school and have a place where they can do it. So we're basically making sure that we're doing the best we can to keep all the kids safe after school and have a place they can be. The floating nurse coverage is also part of the increase. We had to increase the time that we have our Chinese teacher in this year's budget, so we're just capturing that in next year's budget as well. But there are some reductions. I mean, you know, we still are experiencing declining enrollment at Keene High School. I mean, we want to reverse that. We want to be able to attract more kids in the future. But based on declining enrollment and really looking at the program of studies and looking at things closely, looking at different departments, there is a reduction of a health and human service teacher from full-time to part-time, and also in our music teacher as well.
I have to take off today and go to work, but this was a really enlightening experience, you know. I'm very pleased with all of the openness of this process, and I had no idea what to expect, but not all that bad, all things considered. You know, what Ian said at the beginning really rang true for me as I was sitting there thinking, this is not very well attended if there were 100 or so activists who would show up. They could change things in their direction, for better or for worse. As you can see, it is a fairly packed parking lot here today. Lots of people filling the lot to attend the school board meeting. Now this is the location. If you're a follower of many FreeKeene.com videos, this is the location where I was wearing this jacket and I was walking down after handing out some literature. Tim Pelliquin actually handed me a citation over on the corner here. I was walking down the sidewalk. He pulled up in his cruiser. And you can hear the audio of him saying, you know, oh, I see Derek, he's handing out literature. Do you want me to give him his citation? Now, that was a citation for being at another school. And he was prohibiting me from being here, right here. And I am still banned. It is a life ban, is my understanding, for all Keene schools. But it's not in effect on weekends or after 6:30 p.m. on weekdays. So here's that location, I guess about 2 years later. I haven't gone anywhere, neither has he. Hey, if you like these videos and you find them valuable, go to my website, you'll find a lot more. It's at derrickj.me, that's derrickj.me. That's my website. You'll find all the videos that I do, including all the raw videos that I take, the edited ones, the podcasts that I do, live streams, everything is there. All the guest appearances on other media programs. So everything Derek J related is at derrickj.me. And if you like it, consider sending me a Bitcoin donation. Thanks.